Good evening. You are watching The Digital Age, and I'm James Goodale. In 1991, the world was amazed when cruise missiles went around the corners of buildings. If we go to war, the big story will probably be smart bombs. Smart bombs will go into windows, and as we will hear from our guest in a few moments, will do a lot of other things. But guess what? Bin Laden said, smart bombs are not so smart after all, they're dumb. And he said that in a recent radio address. So we're gonna ask ourselves this evening, are smart bombs as dumb as Bin Laden thinks? And joining us tonight to discuss this question is Colonel Walter Givhan, U.S. Air Force, military, he's a colonel in the U.S. Air Force, and a military fellow at the Council of Foreign Relations here in New York City. Welcome, Colonel.
It's a pleasure to be here.
Thank you for joining us. Now, would you mind if I started this off by reading you what, in short, what Bin Laden said about the...
Oh, not at all.
Okay. So our brother fighters in Iraq. Do not be scared by what Americans promote about the greatness of its forces and their smart bombs and laser-guided bombs. For smart bombs have no mentionable effect in the middle of mountains and trenches and plains and forests. As for trenches, they are well camouflaged, and neither smart bombs nor dumb bombs will be able to get them. So use the trenches, as Allah says, may peace be upon them. He said, take cover with the land. Is Bin Laden right?
I would not want to take Bin Laden completely at his word in any case, but he does bring up a couple of points that I think are worth talking about. Let's talk first about what is a smart bomb, because there's a little bit of confusion there in what he's saying about what a smart bomb is. A smart bomb is a weapon that you can give the information to where you want it to go, whether you designate that with a laser or whether you say, these are the coordinates of this particular position and I want it to go there, and it will go there. So that information is what makes it smart in its ability to get there.
Okay, now, would you mind if I just stopped you on that, because this is an information program in the digital age. Tell me again how that works. How do you tell the smart bomb where to go? With a laser, you say?
There are basically two types of smart bombs, and we call these precision weapons. They are able to navigate to a particular spot. Now, the type that most people were familiar with, which saw fairly wide action during the Gulf War, is the laser-guided bomb. And it actually requires an aircraft, or it can be done from the ground, actually, too, to illuminate the target with a laser. And then the bomb tracks that laser energy to the point that's being illuminated.
It tracks the laser.
Yes. Now, obviously, that's something that would be more effective in fair weather. You would have a problem with clouds, things like that, so that the aircraft might not be able to illuminate the target. So at the same time, or really right after the Gulf War, what you had seen was already under development was a second kind of a smart bomb, called a joint direct attack munition. Now, this made use of something that we used for navigation during the Gulf War, that is the global positioning system.
Okay, now hold on for a sec. Joint, what did you say that, JDAM,
joint
right?
Joint direct attack munition, and you will hear the term JDAM.
JDAM. So the JDAMs are the current smart bombs?
Well, you still have both types. You have the laser-guided bomb, and you also have the JDAM. Now, what the JDAM does is it makes use of this constellation of satellites that we have up, the global positioning system, and takes that information. You tell it, I want you to go to these coordinates, and then the bomb has a guidance system that, using global positioning system, will go to the coordinates that you tell it. And it can do that. You can drop it above clouds, as long as you know the coordinates, and it will actually go to where you want it to go.
Okay, now, with the satellite is going around the Earth, right?
Right.
And the satellite tells the JDAM bomb where to go. Who tells the satellite where to put the JDAM bomb?
Yeah. Well, the satellite is a constellation. There are more than one.
Are there many?
And so it's the old idea of triangulation. that if you can know this point, this point, this point, and draw lines, where they meet is where you want to be. And so the system basically uses that kind of technology along with the receiver that the bomb will have to receive this information from the satellites to tell it where it is.
Okay, so but is there a human being in all of this? Is there a human being telling the satellite what to do, or is the satellite programmed?
No, the satellite already, all of this is automatic. The satellite.
The satellite has already got Saddam's castle.
Oh, no, now that information, now we get into what we're getting to on this, sort of on the bin Laden thing.
Yeah, well, we can get to it in a minute. This is better than bin Laden.
It's still important to have the quality of information is very important. The smart bomb is only as smart as the information I put in it.
Right.
So I have to know
garbage
where
in,
I want
garbage
it to go.
Out. Excuse
exactly.
me for interrupting. Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But so I have to know exactly what I want to hit in order to have an effect with this bomb.
Yeah.
So if bin Laden or any person is there, or a group of troops, or a particular target that I want to hit, I've got to have intelligence that tells me that they are at this coordinates. Now, that intelligence could come from many sources. Obviously, it could come from satellites doing surveillance. It could come from unmanned aerial vehicles or drones doing surveillance. It can come from eyes on the ground doing surveillance. But then that information has to be given to the bomb. In the case of a JDAM, a Joint Direct Attack Munition, a GPS-type bomb, then you have to program that information in very quickly to the bomb to say, go here.
Well, where is the human being in all of this?
Well, the human being is in, I would say, several different places. One,
we still need them, don't we?
Oh yeah. Oh, definitely. Yeah. The human being is in a cockpit. I'm a fighter pilot by trade, and we're up there, and we will. We're the ones who are dropping these bombs, whether we're in a B-2, whether we're in an F-16 or an F-15.
Yeah.
And so we're the ones who are going to actually say, okay. I want the bomb to go here, whether it's by pointing a laser at that target or whether it's by putting these coordinates in for it to go there. But the other people who are key to this as well are the people who are going to give us that information. Now, use an example from Afghanistan. We had special forces right. on the ground. And remember, special forces are from all services. So some of these guys were Air Force controllers who were on the ground with Northern Alliance troops. Now, they were able to look and see where the Taliban forces were. They were able, with a laptop, and this guy's sitting on a horse, by the way, laptop, send this information up to a B-52, you know, high as 38,000 feet. And he's able to say, you want the bomb, and the guy on the laptop sends the information, it's data linked up. The B-52 gets information, put the bomb at these coordinates.
Right.
They put the information into the bomb.
Right.
They drop the bomb. The bomb goes where they want it to. And
I want to get to this further when we get back to bin Laden, because when this happened, one wonders whether the whole concept of warfare was changed because of the peculiarities of Afghanistan. But let's save that for a moment and go back now to you have the fellow on the laptop sending digital information, this is the digital age, up to the B-52
in this particular case.
But now you're back in your fighter pilot, right?
Right.
I mean, as a fighter pilot in your plane, and you're picking out the target with a laser beam. How do you know where the hell? You can't see that far, can you?
Well, what you have are targeting pods for the aircraft that are using lasers.
Yeah.
And they have these targeting pods which will give you magnification, give you infrared imaging.
And that comes back up to you.
And that comes back up into the cockpit.
Is it to you as a pilot?
Yes.
We don't have bombardiers anymore.
Well, one person in an aircraft can do a lot more now. He's enabled by...
So you're up there and you're getting the information from the laser, okay?
Yes.
Now, do you use your laptop at that point in time to program the satellite?
You have your own systems within
the... Star Wars, what?
You have your own systems within the aircraft that send the information to the bomb. So, yes, it's, you're entering
And you enter the information that you see effectively?
That you are getting from the ground, in this case. Now, that information could come from other places. You could get the information from the Air Operations Center, which would have gotten surveillance information or targeting information that they would give back to you.
Is that, but do you actually intervene as a human being in this process?
Oh, yes.
You do? Yeah. So are you effectively working at a laptop for all practical purposes?
Well, you could view it in that way. I mean, they're keyboards.
You got keyboards in the plane.
Yes. Well, I mean, it's a keypad that you would enter the information.
We have a keypad on the plane?
Yes. So there are...
And that all information is all going digitally.
Right.
To either to the satellite?
Well, no. The information is going to the bomb.
What the bomb is getting
from the satellite
is
guidance information. The bomb says, well, I want to go to these coordinates. How do I find those coordinates?
Yeah.
I find those coordinates by receiving the information from the satellites and determining where I am. And then I know if I know where I am, I know how to get where I want to go because the satellites are giving me this information, this positional information.
Well, so as you program, that's a moment of truth, but you got to do that pretty quickly. So you must type pretty quickly.
It's something that you're...
You can't be...
It's not like a keyboard that you would sit there. I mean, so it's a matter of a few steps.
Is that hard to do?
No, it's part of your training.
I know you're trained, but isn't it hard to...
No, actually, that's... Now, but what you... I think what you're getting at here that's worth talking about, though...
Yeah, I'm glad we have someone to
that's very, very critical... is that the human is in the loop. Yeah. And the human being has that authority to say, I trust this information, this information is good, and I'm going to put it in, and I'm going to let the bomb go there. And that release authority, if you want to call it that, the authority to employ the weapons, is very critical. And especially, as you can imagine, in situations where you have troops, friendly troops, close to enemy forces, and now you're employing these weapons in close proximity. So you have to be very comfortable, and we have procedures, we have training, we do this in exercises all the time, but you have to be very comfortable with doing that, because that's a moment of truth. Wish them dead, this is a video game. No, there's a real bomb coming off this airplane, and it's gonna go down, and it's gonna do some damage, and I need to make sure that I protect the friendlies from that damage if they are a factor as well, or that I make sure that target is indeed the target I want to hit.
How many hours of training would you need for that?
Oh, we put millions of dollars worth of training into our troops or into our pilots too. First of all, you have to know the system, the aircraft in this case, backwards and forwards. You have to go out and you have to exercise this all the time. It's constantly part. When we are not in combat, that's all we're doing is training and getting ready to go into combat.
Okay, so that's fascinating. All that information effectively is going digitally to the smart bomb.
Yes, and in the case of the joint direct attack munition. And that information is being passed digitally, as I said, in the case of the laptop going up. In this case, a B-52, so where you still do have... Right. A weapon system operator, which was in the old parlance would be the bombardier in this case, who's making sure that information is put in correctly and going
to the
bomb.
When I opened the show, or just generally speaking, the cruise missiles were a big story, and of course the smart bombs were a big story too. But smart bombs may be even more of a story this time. In terms of percentage of the amount of bombs that go down, if there is a war in Iraq as compared to the 1991, how would those numbers differentiate?
It's hard to know exactly, but I think you can make some generalizations. Less than 10% of what we dropped in Desert Storm in the Gulf War were precision weapons. In this war, I would see upwards of 80% at least. You may actually get into the 90s. Now, someone might ask the question following that, well, why would you not use all precision weapons? Well, there's still targets that lend themselves to using, if you want to call them dumb bombs, an area weapon. That is, you have a target that's widely distributed, like a troop concentration or several, and you actually want to cover an area. And it actually works better in that case for a B-52, for example, or a B-1, to drop a string of dumb bombs and to actually cover that area. When you see that happen, because obviously they're dropping a fairly large number of those, that tends to bring the percentage overall down for
the
smart ones.
Okay, but the bottom line is we've gone from 10, we have the capability, whether it is war or not, of going from 10 to 90% of all bombs dropped are smart bombs. That's a big change. Now, let me go back to you. You're sitting here taking all this information and sending the information digitally to the bomb. How does that compare with what you did if you were in the 1991 war?
Well, let's say that you're out in an aircraft that didn't have that kind of precision capability. In fact, we weren't using the Joint Direct Attack munition.
Okay, so
let's say that you're in an aircraft that doesn't have the capability to do the laser designation. Now what you're still doing, you still have a system, an inertial navigational system that tells you where you are in the aircraft that you've programmed in. And you've programmed in target coordinates based upon the best information that you could get, or you've been able to look perhaps visually and see the target. Now, then you're going to use what the systems on the aircraft to still try to put the bomb exactly on a particular target.
Is that what you did? Is that what happened last time? What I'm trying to get at is, how much has our technology improved in the precision, if I may use that word, of the examples we've talked about? If you didn't have the ability in 1991 to take all this information and send it to a JDAM, how much greater ability does that technology give you than you had before, which you were just describing, the previous technology, effectively?
The previous technology was pretty good. It couldn't make a dumb bomb smart, but it could get it pretty close to much closer than, say, in Vietnam with kind of aiming systems we have. However, now, especially with the Joint Direct Attack munition, this kind of precision capability is available. So to almost any aircraft that we have in the inventory that's capable of dropping bombs.
So the big thing is that the JDAM, which is what detachable is, I understand it, and you add it to a dumb bomb, did I have that right?
It's a guidance system,
It's a guidance system. So the basic idea is we've got more guidance systems than do we have anything like a JDAM before?
No, we weren't using, the only precision bomb that we had were the laser-guided bombs.
Oh, you started to tell me that, and I interrupted.
And then, of course, the dumb bombs, which, as I said, the plane systems had gotten smarter, which could put the dumb bombs closer, but it couldn't guarantee that you would necessarily hit the target or get the effects that you want.
So the big difference on the smart bombs is the fact that we've gone from the laser technology, if I can call it this, to digital technology.
Right. Let me give you three quick points to show you some of that. Yeah. World War II, you still probably hear about 1,000 plane raids going over to hit it.
Right.
You know, here's one target, and we would send hundreds of planes literally over just because of the imprecision of what they could do to get one target. We get up now to the Gulf War, and because of the laser-guided bombs, you could actually get, with certain platforms, one plane, one bomb, one target. Now we are to the point with B-2s, B-52s, B-1s, having multiple JDAMs, the Joint Direct Attack Munition, GPS bombs. B-2, for example, can hit 16 separate targets with one, and almost simultaneously, dropping its bombs, precision-guided, going down to the target. So the mass, if you will, that you can achieve just with one or a couple of aircraft now is greater than the mass you could achieve in World War II with hundreds, even 1,000 aircraft.
Well, it's absolutely amazing. So I suppose you can't tell me, but how long will it take to knock everything out with JDAMs?
Well,
I can't ask you that, but I can ask you, if you had something like Baghdad somewhere, we didn't use these in Kosovo, I guess, did we? We used just cruise missiles.
Oh, we did. Yes, we did.
Oh, we did? We used JDAMs in Kosovo?
Yes, we did.
How did they work in Kosovo?
They worked fine. Again, they go where you want them to go. So it's just a question, again, of getting that information. It's also a question of what you want to achieve. We talk about effects that we want to achieve. How do we achieve those effects? Well, the effects that we want to achieve determine what targets we're going to hit. So it really depends on any particular strategy. For example, if you did not want to take out the infrastructure of a particular place, say you didn't want to take down all the power lines or the power stations by destroying them, you might do what we have done since the first, since the Gulf War, and drop carbon filaments on the power lines to short them out.
Well, you know, if the JDAMs are so darn smart, why didn't we get bin Laden?
Well, if we didn't get him, which I'm still I don't know. Well, but let's just say that we
didn't. Let's assume we didn't. I mean, he's putting out radio broadcasts, okay.
Camouflage and deception. That's the one of the oldest things that's been known, is that you try to hide your position so that someone doesn't know where you are. This is why information is important. This is why the quality of information that's provided to the bomb is absolutely critical. And so that information that you get, you're going to have to get from multiple sources. And we're always trying to improve our sensors
You're talking about information, online information, immediate information. In other words, in the Afghanistan war, as you said earlier, there were special operations forces out there with the computers saying, I see,
exactly,
not bin Laden, but I see someone who looks like bin Laden, or I see actually the Taliban, and da-da-da-da-da, it goes back up to the plane and boom. But if we don't know anyone's there, it's garbage in, garbage out.
Exactly. So intelligence.
So why doesn't Iraq just, they know all this, right? They know as much as we're talking about.
Well,
right?
Again, they know a certain amount. Camouflage and deception is, again, an old practice in war. The thing that you have to have still, you have to have that sensor information, which is getting better and better. The kind of radars that we have that can see things, the infrared sensors that we're starting to use, they're getting more and more sophisticated. But is technology the end all? No, you still have to have that human intelligence that tells you where a particular target is or a particular person. And even barring, one last point on that, even barring that, yes, you can use these kind of tactics, but what do? They also restrict what you can do if you're using them. Mobility, for example, is very important to most armed forces. You cannot move if you're dependent upon having to hide yourself in a hole, for example. And so that may keep you from actually doing your mission. We saw examples of that in Kosovo, for example, in which there was some success in camouflaging the actual Serbian forces, but that also restricted their ability to move and to accomplish any mission that they wanted to. So you pay a price for it as well.
So basically Bin Laden's point is, in the part that I read out at the beginning of the show, is disperse, don't take these people on the conventional basis, take them on a non-conventional basis, which some people, I take it, would call asymmetrically. Take them on an asymmetrical war, go out and hide in the caves, hide in the trenches, and let them have Baghdad, and we will forever be there, and they'll never get us out. Now, is that going to be? Would that be effective in this particular situation?
On the surface, it doesn't seem it would to me. You've just given up the capital of the country. You've given up everything that's in the country.
But you're fighting for the cause.
But you may survive, but to what end?
Do you think this is going to be a land war or an air war?
I think that any war that we undertake now is always going to be, one, a joint operation. So they're going to be, all the services are going to be involved in some way or another. And depending upon the particular problem, you're going to have various roles played by air power. And when I say air power, I'm not just talking about Air Force. I'm talking about all the capabilities the Navy, the Marines, the Air Force, the Army have that relate to using air as a weapon. What you will see, I think, more and more is a synergy between the forces, so that air power has always been an enabler in air superiority, being freedom of action, the ability to do what you want to do without being attacked by it from the air. But now more and more, it's one of the kinds of force that you want to bring to bear, and it will achieve those effects of shock by being able to hit with such a mass, as I talked about before, that it creates opportunities for your ground forces. And in a particular situation, again, it depends on the situation, you may need less.
Would you say that Afghanistan was almost a pure air war? Because what happened was that the guys with their special forces, with their laptops, plus, and there weren't many of them, 300 or 400 of them, and there were 200 CIA agents or something like that who were ferreting out information, I take it, to give to whomever, including the special forces. I may be making this up, but this is what a layman looks at. The special force guy get on the computer, goes to air power, And the precision and the information that is involved in all that process, as you just pointed out, scares the living bananas out of the Taliban, and they take off. And the guys on horseback, our guys, can hardly catch up with them. So isn't it possible that all we're looking at is another air war in Iraq, where impact of precision bombs is going to be so tremendous that effectively air power will win it?
No, I don't think so. First of all, in the first instance that you're describing it, you have to remember we were leveraging a ground force that was already there, the Northern Alliance.
How much of a ground force was it?
What I think it tells you, though, is that when you have air power on your side, even a force like the Northern Alliance, whatever you want to make of them, it's a tremendous multiplier. It has a tremendous effect. It enables you to do things that you may not, obviously they weren't able to do before American air power was coupled with them. Now, their forces were completely different from what you'll see in Iraq. Without getting into any what strategy might be, it's obviously known that Iraq has still a substantial conventional force. Upwards of 400,000 troops that you'd have to deal with.
Now this
that's
would be
going
the royal,
to require a ground
the royal,
force.
What is the Royal Guard? What is it?
The Republican Guard.
And there you're talking about.
Yeah, but they have
Guard?
A regular army. They have a Republican Guard. They have an elite Republican Guard, special Republican Guard.
Right.
So, any force like that, to keep it in the general, if you're ever having to deal with a large ground force like that, no, you're not going to have any kind of an air power only strategy.
Yeah.
You're going to end up having to go with ground forces. Now, the mix, depending on what you're trying to do, the mix of ground and air, it remains to be seen. The important thing is that, I think we get hung up on can you do it with air alone or can you do it with ground or whatever alone. We fight as a joint force, and the synergy that is created when you have those two joined together, you get incredible things happening.
Colonel, we've come to the end, so I've got to ask you the $64 question. Was Bin Laden right when he said that smart bombs are and were dumb?
No, he's absolutely wrong. Smart bombs are only as smart as you make them, and the important thing is giving them the right information.
But they're smarter than Bin Laden.
If we give them the information.
Thank you very much for coming
by. My pleasure.
And thank you for coming by. Come by next week and learn more about the digital age. For the digital age, I am James Goodale. Good night.